Kipling probably said it best, something hidden, go and find it. Go and look behind the ranges, something lost behind the ranges, lost and waiting for you. Go. The Tibetans call it Chumalungma, Mother Goddess of the Earth. Mount Everest, the highest mountain peak in the world. Mystic clouds form a protective shroud around this most spiritual of pinnacles. Ghosts haunt the high mountain ridges. The ghosts of memory, Hillary, Whitaker, Unseld. Everest holds the memories of many. And like all fleeting moments which must come to pass, the memories of success and failure, of pain, and yet accomplishment. Mount Everest was first observed in 1849. The first attempt to climb it was made 72 years later. It was another 32 years before the summit was reached. The memories are vivid of Hillary and Tenzing on the first ascent of Everest in 1953. Of the first American summit ascent 10 years later in 1963 by Jim Whitaker.
In 1953, Edmund Hillary's successful ascent of Everest with Sherpa Tenzing captured the imagination of the world. Hillary climbed the South Col route with a large team of climbers and an army of Sherpas. Oxygen was used to reach the summit of the mountain because it was not known if man could survive above 26,000 feet without it. Perhaps Hillary's greatest achievement was smashing forever the psychological fear of the unknown that the summit of Everest had always represented to previous generations of climbers.
But for each success that Everest grants, a toll is extracted. On the historic 1963 American expedition, Jake Brittenbach was killed in an ice fall. And so they still come. A group which totals some of America's best men and women climbers have converged on the mountains of Utah to begin preparations for an historic journey. The goal being to put the first American woman on the summit of Mount Everest and to hang glide from the slopes of Everest and soar to the summit. The expedition is led by Steve McKinney, the five-time world record holder in international speed skiing and a member of the 1983 Mount Everest expedition.
Americans to China 1986 will have a number of firsts, probably the last firsts to be done on Mount Everest. Primarily, the first American women will hopefully reach the summit, and there's a better chance of that happening on this expedition than ever before in history. The other first, something that hasn't been done on Mount Everest before, is hang gliders flying off of the highest mountain in the world. Hang gliders have flown off the second highest, the third highest, and the fifth highest mountains in the world, but not off of Everest itself. Also, of course, we have a number of highly qualified, probably the best men alpine climbers in the United States prepared to summit on Mount Everest.
Climbing leader Kim Schmitz was a member of the 1983 Everest West Ridge Expedition and a world-class climber of major mountains throughout the world.
I have tremendous respect for every climber on the trip. They could just as well be in my position as anyone else. They have very good judgment. That's why they're alive.
Other team members include administrator and climber Heidi Benson, climber and administrator Kim Carpenter, Carl Buckland, fundraiser Alan Laffam, China consultant Kent Morrison, hang glider Bob Carter, Jim Bridewell and Steve Martz, speed skier Craig Kalanika.
Craig has climbed in the extreme conditions found in the Himalayas during a circumnavigation of Mount Everest that left him wandering for 5 days without food, running from a snowstorm in search of shelter in a Nepalese village. In Yosemite, he hung for 6 days suspended on the vertical overhanging smooth granite wall of El Capitan, one of the most technically demanding climbs in the world, where fear is the worst enemy.
If you get scared into a state of paranoia and you're doing something really difficult, there's a good chance you're going to blow it. The things I'm doing are fairly extreme, to where if you make a mistake, the consequences could be rather serious. And they are rather serious. A lot of my friends have found out what those consequences are. They're not around anymore. So you're toying with something that might take your life away if you make a mistake.
Expedition doctor, Catherine Collins. Climber, Rennie Jackson. Climbers, Evelyn Lees, Ann and Chaz McQuarrie. Emergency physician, Dick Wallen. Climber and avalanche forecaster, Rick Wyatt. World champion hang glider, Larry Tudor. Climber, Catherine Freer. For the American women, Everest represents the pursuit of dreams. But others have pursued those dreams. Marty Hoy was a young Utah woman who pursued the dreams of Everest on the 1982 expedition. Marty Hoy died on Everest. 1982 expedition member Jim Wickwire explains.
And just as I was beginning to move to put my pack on, Marty said, let me get out of your way. And she stepped to one side, and I heard this pinging sound, and looked up and could see that she was falling backwards down the slope. I could only watch in horror as she slid at an ever-increasing rate of speed down the 45-degree slope. And about 2,000 feet down is an enormous ice cliff. Although I could not see her go over that ice cliff, I was certain that she did with the speed she was traveling. So she fell about 6,000 feet from the rock we were sitting on to the glacier at the foot of the north face of Everest. After the fall, when she was out of sight, I looked back and there was her jumar still attached to the fixed rope, and her entire seat harness, which includes a belt that would go around her waist, and that belt had come undone. I can only speculate, but it would appear that she did not loop the belt back through the buckle, which would prevent the belt from sliding through that buckle. It was just a shock to see that open waist harness lying there on the slope, still attached to the rope.
The 1986 expedition will fly to Beijing, China, and then travel on to Chengdu. The journey will offer the opportunity for cultural exchange. The Chinese have not seen a hang glider, and one can only imagine the magic as seen through their eyes.
Heard of hang gliders. I had to explain to them what it was all about. And when they heard, they were very open and objective, and they wanted to be partners with me on this. They wanted it to happen. So they broke some of their own rules. It was very difficult to get an Everest permit. They gave me one to do this. So here we go.
Everest has never been successfully skied. And with five-time world record holder for speed skiing, Steve McKinney, on the expedition, that possibility could become reality. An attempt to ski Mount Everest was made by Yushiro Mura of Japan in 1970. It's estimated that he reached a speed of 160 miles per hour in 2.5 minutes. He fell, narrowly escaping death.
I felt the ice on my back. Falling, just falling. Just be strong. the big rock. The Bergschund.
Everest is unique in its formation in that it has a ridge, a famous ridge called the West Ridge. It's at least 2 miles long, perfectly smooth. And this whole hang gliding idea came into my head while I sat on that ridge at 24,000 feet on a 1983 Everest expedition, and I watched a large condor-type bird called a lammergeier soar back and forth effortlessly without flapping. And it was immediately obvious this was a perfect place for a hang glider. And it's a fairly well-known fact that where a big bird like that can soar, a hang glider certainly can soar. And there the proof was right in front of my face.
The selection of the pilots was crucial. For this phase of the expedition to succeed, the pilots had to be among the best in the world. Bob Carter, the first to fly successfully off El Capitan in Yosemite. Larry Tudor, the master, the world champion, probably the best of the world. And Steve McKinney, known for his speed skiing, Steve has been hang gliding for many years, a team which has the expertise for success on Everest. Death seems to be part of the spirit of the mountains. And maybe those spirits which reside there find a meaning and value which they never knew in life. Dan Racanelli was slated to be a leading member of the Everest 86 expedition. The world champion aerobatic flyer had an enthusiasm for the expedition that was hard to match.
This is kind of an adventure. It's one of the highest, farthest away places in the world. And I think it would really suit me just fine to get over there and make an attempt at that mountain. You know, and just the attempt is going to be the adventure. If we make it, well, that's going to be wonderful. And I'm sure that'll be a great payoff for it. But even if we don't, the adventure is going to be really good for me. And that's my drive.
But unfortunately, Dan Racanelli would never feel the winds of Everest.
Yeah, it was just really a tragedy. He was at a hang gliding meet down in Australia, and a friend of his got caught in some electrical wires. And he was already on the ground walking over to help him, and he was talking to him. And a gust hit the glider, and the kite shifted and hit him in the face and electrocuted him. To us, we plan on dedicating the expedition to him. He's going to be with us there, both in the spirit, and he'll be with us in the air.
Craig Kalanika describes what it's like to climb high
really
ice.
Beautiful, and all the different colors and ice are just amazing. Little rainbow colors happening there, and the different textures and consistencies of the ice. You hear water rushing underneath there at times. There's always a changing situation going on with ice climbing. There's constantly a new thing to deal with on the same climb. Where at the bottom it might be really thick and solid. And then as you get further and further up, it starts thinning out. And so you have to change your climbing technique. And that makes for an unusually fun sport.
After investigating the condition of the ice while still on the road, Craig makes the decision to attempt a solo ascent of the remaining 300 feet of ice wall. At this point in the game, ice climbing becomes, as Craig puts it, a no-fall sport, where a mistake means end of game.
I look at myself as an endangered species. There's only one of me. So I protect that as much as I can. I always stay within the realm of my own safety. Everything that I do, I know I'm capable of. Sometimes I ask myself the question, why do I do this? But it doesn't happen too often. It only happens when it's not fun anymore. Oh. I could be having fun on the beach somewhere, watching all the beautiful girls or whatever, swimming in warm water. But it's exciting. and it's really not that dangerous. For me, I've spent most of my life doing this, and it's like second nature to me.
I think there's a lot more commitment here because most of these people are climbers, and they understand what needs to be done more so than say some other expeditions. A lot depends on the weather, but in fact, everything depends on the weather. You can have the best climbing team in the world, and if the weather isn't with you, then there's nothing you can do.
The ridges of Everest are haunted by the ghosts of the past, the footsteps of Hillary and Unseld. But to all who go, a new quest begins. The prize is not the capturing of the summit, but the adventure of it all, the challenge. Everest tells its own story, and for all who go, rides the hopes and dreams of all who aspire to do great things, reach unreachable heights, and the hope that all may return.
The thing I worry about most is dying in the mountains. I don't want to die in the mountains.
Olympic gold medalist Donna DeVerona is at Mount Everest.
For 1,000 years, the Potala Palace in Lhasa has stood at the center of religious and political culture in Tibet. For many centuries, Tibet was a country hidden away in a high corner of the world. But recently, its borders opened again to the west. Two teams of American athletes have come here to try for mountaineering firsts. Catherine Cullinane and Mary Kay Brewster, along with Sue Giller, will attempt to be the first American women to reach the summit of Mount Everest. At the same time, another expedition will attempt to be the first to soar off the mountain with hang gliders. It rises 29,028 feet above sea level. But first, you have to get to it. For the climbers, it's a week of planes and trains, where hillside shrines suggest the contrast between old and new.
Sacred in here.
In Tibet's world of monasteries and yak butter candles, spiritualism seems close at hand.
We should leave an offering.
Yeah, I think we should. I've done this every time when I've come here and always had good luck.
Finally acclimatized in the capital city of Lhasa, the team prepares to move above 12,000 feet. Catherine Cullinane spins prayer wheels, whose clatter beseeches the gods for the safety of the team. Grinding uphill in old Chinese army trucks, the expedition continues toward Everest. Each day brings a new and demanding elevation. As the team passes through land scarred by glaciers, the trucks must negotiate the powerful streams that run down from the Himalayas by the dozen. This is Mount Everest, the highest mountain in the world, and I'm on the northern or Tibetan side at 17,000 feet. To give you some idea about how high we are, the tip of the Great Swiss Matterhorn is still a half a mile below this point. We're at base camp, and our story begins right here. First, the high camps must be stocked. These yaks, sure-footed cousins of the American buffalo, carry about 120 pounds on their backs. In all, they will transport over 2 tons of supplies. After making good progress in the initial stages of the climb, all the team members return to base for the puja ceremony, a traditional Buddhist blessing in a very untraditional shrine. The participants throw grains of rice into the air after each prayer. The head Sherpa, Na Wang Yanden, ties links of red cord around each climber's neck. The cord must not be removed until the expedition is safely completed. A toss of flour indicates that the climbing may once again resume. Across the parking lot, as the climbers call the rocky stretch between the base camps, the wind is up and the hang gliding team is unloading an unusual cargo. One of the members is in a class by himself. Larry Tudor holds the world's distance record in a glider. Bob Carter, the climber and hang glider, will also attempt Everest. Rounding out the team is Steve McKinney, five-time world speed skiing champion.
The two things seem very similar to me, speed skiing and hang gliding, especially the moments of takeoff, because both required extreme commitment. to me, this is an important blend, the blend of reality and dream, of spirit and technology. I don't believe that East is East and West is West and never the twain shall meet, because here on this mountain in Asia, hang gliders will fly.
In conjunction with their precedent-setting attempt to soar Everest, the three hang gliders flew in Tibetan cities above the 15,000-foot plateau on the road to Everest. From the beginning of the trip, the members of this expedition had been observers of culture and wind patterns. Larry Tudor walks by the traditional and ever-present prayer flags. The Tibetans marveled at these men who had the gift of flight. Bob Carter takes in a bird's eye view of Tibet as he soars over the bare hills that would be considered mountains anywhere else in the world. The town is colorful, quiet, and still in another century. Bob is a great asset to the team. He's one of the few athletes to climb Yosemite's El Capitan and then soar off of it. He's also an accomplished skier. Currents and corkscrew winds, so common in mountainous regions, are nevertheless gentle on this day of flying. Above the city of Zagar, Larry Tudor launches into the perfect clarity of the Tibetan sky. As far as hang gliding goes, Larry's in the business of breaking his own world records. No one has even come close to his distance record, which he set while taking off from California and landing in Nevada. The fortress, which used to protect the town from invaders, was partially destroyed during the Chinese Cultural Revolution in the 1970s. Most of Tibet's sacred monasteries and shrines met the same fate, though the Tibetans themselves remain a proud and devout people.
He's okay.
I'm so warm.
Oh, that was fun. Finally got to fly in Tibet.
When awe turns to curiosity among the children, they gather at the landing site, giving the adults the courage to be curious as well. Traditionally, kite flyers, Tibetans are quick to examine a kite that can carry a man.
Oh, that was great.
A colorful Tibetan kite is used to test the shifting winds over base camp.
Let it out.
From a moraine above the camp at 18,500 feet, Steve McKinney launches into unseen and uncertain currents. As he flies, the wind suddenly dies out. He has nothing to stay afloat on. He stalls out. Steve beaks the landing, a term hand gliders use to describe the nose of the glider and the flyer hitting the ground at the same time. His equipment may be damaged, but it sure helped to soften his impact. And although he's bruised and shaken, Steve recovers quickly with the help of the Sherpas. Steve, that was a pretty hairy flight. What happened up there?
You can't land very easily at 17,000 feet with no wind. You come dropping out of the sky like a rock, which is what I did.
Well, what did you learn from all this, do you think?
Well, I learned from all this, I think that my mother is a horsewoman and taught me a lot about horses, and one of the basic precepts of riding is you've never been off, you've never been on. You kind of get something out of the way with. I've got my fall out of the way now here in the Himalayas, and I'm ready to go.
While testing the hang gliders, lead climbers Craig Kalanika, Pete Appens, and Andy Politz went on ahead of the rest of the team and started fixing the acquired campsites and ropes up the most difficult route on Everest. They start from base camp at 17,000 feet with yaks hauling loads to advanced base camp at 18,500 feet. Then on to Camp 1 at 19,700 feet, high up on the Rumbuk Glacier under the massive north base of Everest. From Camp 1, they start the difficult climbing and fixing of ropes up a steep face of rock, snow, and ice on the West Ridge route of Everest. Camp 2 is established at 22,000 feet, and Camp 3 is at 24,000 feet. This is the camp which the hang gliders are to fly off from and soar to the summit of Mount Everest. But as we all know, the weather and mountain always have a way of controlling the destiny of all outcomes of such endeavors.
From their advanced base camp, the hang gliders have a picture-perfect view of the north face of Everest. Struck by the variety and strength of the unpredictable winds. Not a good omen for safe flying. The jet stream sweeps down from higher elevations, creating a complex pattern of thermals around the rock mass of Everest. The heavy storms that have pinned down the women on the North Ridge make their way across the mountain to halt the hang gliders. Pilots have also reached a point where they can go no higher in the face of wind and snow. Nevertheless, they try on the next day to reach the 24,000-foot terrace on the West Ridge. Beaten back once again by deep snow, the pilots retreat to advanced base camp, where they reassess their chances.
I just talked to the boys up there at the top camp, and they say it's really dumping up there.
Oh, yeah, it's really dumping right here, isn't it?
Yeah, boy.
This isn't just the afternoon poos, is it?
No, this is a real storm.
Well, we could probably launch a little bit lower, huh? Maybe Camp 2 or something?
Camp 2. Now, there you go. You know, without having to get into that dangerous avalanche zone.
Yeah, maybe when it's post-frontal, it'll be north, and we can just restore right up the face.
Yeah.
That'd be good.
We've got a contingency plan here, then.
That's good. Well, I hope this doesn't keep up.
5 days of continuous storm and increasing doubt on the part of the pilots. The sky clears. Knowing this might be their only chance at the first flight on Everest, Steve McKinney and the others set out quickly. They reach a site at 22,000 feet, assemble the glider, and hastily pack snow for a launch ramp. Already storm clouds are building ominously on the ridge. bringing with them the threat of unpredictable winds. But high-speed risk is nothing new for Steve McKinney. It was 10:30 a.m., October 5th, 1986, when Steve became the first to soar Everest in a hang glider. During the flight across the North Face, he reached a downwind speed of 50 miles per hour. Turning through the thin air, Steve uses the rotor winds coming off the west ridge ahead of the storm to extend his flight.
I think prophecies are being fulfilled here. The Dalai Lama for many, many years dreamed he was a kite, wanted to be a kite. And here we are in the Dalai Lama's country doing what he most wanted to do himself.
He glides almost effortlessly toward the glacier at 19,800 feet, a new world record for the highest landing by a hang glider. For Steve McKinney, it's the culmination of a lifetime of skiing and 14 years of hang gliding.
Well, I knew how to work this harness. This is my second flight in the harness. The first flight was down on Danger Bluff, and I didn't swing out and get vertical soon enough. Did you see how I got vertical?
Yeah.
Very soon. I got wriggled down. That's how come I stalled out down at the bottom, because I didn't come down soon enough. But I feel like I've been given a blessed gift. That's for sure. It's a dream come true.
First flight out forever.
What else is there to do but follow your dreams, you know? And it was well worth it.
The team decides to head down the mountain. Larry and Bob conclude the avalanche danger is too great to attempt a flight from higher slopes. The winter winds are unsympathetic to these frail man-made wings, the wings that briefly brought color to Everest. It was a season of storms in Tibet, a season for unusual sights on Everest, unusual hopes, and unusual endings. Though Everest still remains unclimbed by an American woman, there will be other chances. The very uncertainty of the outcome is part of the lure of the big mountains. These adventurers may come back to Everest, but for now, they return to other lives in other places to dream the long dream of beginning again.
Mutual of Omaha, Spirit of Adventure is brought to you by Mutual of Omaha, the people who also bring you Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom.